say thanks to everybody that has been wishing me well on my recovery from chipmunk cheeks and the oral surgery that I had on Tuesday. And if it gets too bad, I'll just take a pain pill and sit down and somebody else will finish for me. We'll see how this works out. It's been kind of an interesting week. And you're probably going to see where the medication kicks in as I put this sermon together. Because when I did it, it had a coherent thought that went all the way through it in my world, wherever that was. So this may appeal to you, and it may not. So we'll see. We'll see. The Sermon on the Mount is what we want to talk about today, but it goes back to where we are today in our 8-week series of the Great Invitation and this idea of you're invited. And so as we look at this Great Invitation that we started with, that we're going to do 4 weeks of teaching, which is where we start now, and the 4 weeks that we planned before, which started with the baptism and went to the come and see. Then last week would have been the call of the disciples, where Andrew and Philip were talking together and Peter got in on the conversation. So we went from the recollection of our baptism. The reason we do what we do is contained in our baptismal liturgy, because I have this professed faith in Jesus Christ. And so that beckons me to come, to take a close look at what's going on and what Christ requires of me. And as I look closer and closer, then how is that going to get me into answer my call to ministry? And yes, everyone sitting here has a call to ministry of some kind. That there is something that God is calling you to do to build this kingdom of God that is mentioned in our reading this morning. This the Beatitudes, the Sermon on the Mount. That Jesus, the first teaching sermon that Jesus had. And so we're going to look at these words and see how that kind of falls right in line with where we're at today in our discipleship and answering the great invitation to want to take a closer walk with Christ and to want to really, really live into the expectations that God has upon us and that Christ calls us as the perfect model. The visible image of the invisible God that is doing this teaching, the one in whom the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, is saying, I want to teach you something today. I want you to hear what I have to say, and then I want you to react to it. We're going to have to get there. So we have this idea that this Jesus Sermon on the Mount. Before I go there, though, bear with me. That I want to make sure that everybody is up on social media the way that they should be. So does everybody understand when we talk about speaking in hashtag plus, hashtag this, hashtag that? You've seen the commercial where it annoys you to no end, where they keep talking about that. Does everybody know what that means?
No.
At least the choir's honest, though. I guess some of them are all over the place with that. It's kind of interesting. It's kind of interesting because this idea of hashtag blessed, the way that it works is very simple. First of all, I want you to check out the video first. You got to look at this because this is the way people talk today. Things are not the same.
Hey, Justin, what's up?
Not much, Jimmy. Hashtag jump.
We're busy working. Hashtag rise and grind. Hashtag is it Friday yet?
Hey, check it out. I brought you some cookies. Hashtag homemade, hashtag open the raisin, hashtag show me the cookie! Sweet!
Hashtag don't mind if I don't.
Pretty good.
Hashtag get my cookie on. Hashtag I'm the real cookie monster. Hashtag
go
for
the cookie. Hashtag
that's good. Okay, you get the idea? No. I still don't understand it, do you? Yeah, see, it's pretty stupid if you ask me, but... But it goes there, and there's a reason for wanting to go there. First of all, if people and cultures change, we don't do things the way that we used to anymore. In fact, this the idea of why I know about speaking and you know with hashtag on Twitter is because in seminary I did this. That we would walk into I took a class on Daniel, the book of Daniel, and we walk in, and the professor would hook up his laptop to the screen above him, and we would all hashtag something. That a code that he put in on Twitter, And while he's giving the lecture on Daniel, we're talking about it. So every time I type into my computer and hit send, that it goes up on the screen. And pretty soon we're all that's in this lecture hall is talking to each other about what's happening right now. Well, I wouldn't have said that. I didn't think Daniel was like that. And what made him go there? But see, you see how complicated it gets? But hashtagging is a way that we can all talk about the same thing at the same time. And so we look at this idea right here, hashtag blessed. Do you realize what happens when you go and Google that right there? Yeah, everybody that's blessed is now talking about their blessing together. Yeah, they're all hashtag blessed. If you Google this, what you'll find is some people eating salads made out of $100 bills that are blessed beyond imagination. They are hashtag blessed. They're living in mansions. They are hashtag blessed because they're walking white tigers. You see? That's their idea of blessing. You ever see anybody that puts this on Facebook or other social medias that says, I'm so blessed? We had this conversation on the way down to Las Vegas yesterday. What does that mean? I'm so blessed. Yes, and you can't escape, can you? You got to tell me. What does it mean to be blessed? You know, I got the Merriam-Webster dictionary here. I'll help you out with that. It's right here. To be blessed means that you are blissfully happy or contented. That's about 90% of you out here that I've seen this morning. Maybe. Or how about this one here? This one says, divinely or supremely favored. That's the other 10%.
Amen.
All of you are hashtag blessed in some way, right? Or all of you are blessed. What does that mean?
God's favor.
Your favor? Have you ever seen somebody,
now
I want you to put this Sermon on the Mount in the back of that who God is saying is blessed are, and then keep talking. You know, those who mourn, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, those the meek, those who are merciful, and keep talking about this idea of being blessed now. Does it change? Yeah, it kind of did, didn't it? And see, this is why when this is the point that if you go on social media and you figure out who's blessed, you know, they're all the people that are blessed are the ones that are doing extravagantly stupid things. You know, that show just how blessed they are. They're not truly blessed. They're pretty much bragging about their situation. They're talking about not the fact that they're blessed. Most of them are lucky. Or you know, happen to be at the right place at the right time, or happen to fall into good fortune, or have good jobs, or do all this. Does that mean that God has blessed them divinely? No. No. And so we start to think about this Sermon on the Mount. Yeah, you keep using that word, but I'm not sure it means what you think it means. How about this for hashtag bless, or for being blessed? You know, that you ever see it on social media that Harris killed in a car wreck last week. Funeral's on Saturday. Hashtag mourning. I'm feeling blessed. Yeah. Does that make sense? No, it doesn't make any sense. But Jesus is saying, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Can we square that up? You bet we can. You bet we can. See, the idea of blessing has come upon us. It's been passed down from the Old Testament, that you're blessed if things are going good for you. You're not if something's going bad for you. If there's something that you're afflicted with, somebody's sin. If you're doing good and life is good and the animals are just reproducing and you've got a whole bunch of herds and all of this stuff that's out there and the grapes are more abundant than they ever would, you must be living a righteous life. And if you're not, then somebody's sinned. Just own it up, you know, just confess it, own up to it, and it'll be good, and God will bless you, and now you can put the t-shirt on. Otherwise, you can't wear that t-shirt. No. But Jesus has got a little different story for this idea about who is blessed and why they're blessed and how we're to understanding the blessings of God and the kingdom of God, because this is where it gets different. Jesus is saying, in the kingdom of heaven, in God's reign, the kingdom of heaven that has come near, is at hand, that's present in the person of Christ. It's kind of like when Christ is quoted in Matthew as saying, you've heard it said of old, but I say, things are changing. In Christ, things have changed. And so you've got a lot of the people, who's there visiting with them that is up on the Sermon on the Mount? Christians? No. We don't have anything yet.
Jews,
that would be a good probably approximation. He's there sometimes. He was all around Galilee up in there. There's just a mix of people. Some may affiliate with the Jews. Some may just, I'm not anything. I'm kind of like us. We're just here. Yeah. And that's the people that he's got surrounding him right now. And this is the people that he sits down there and speaks to them and tells them something right off the bat that goes totally against anything else that they might have thought. You're blessed when you mourn. Because in the new kingdom, because of the way things are, you'll be comforted. And if this is not something that when the end of the world comes, you'll get your just reward and everything will be all right. It's now. It's right here, right now. You're blessed. You're blessed because you have taken that step and you're entering into the kingdom of God that I am bringing and establishing right now. And if you will buy onto this and jump on this freight train, it's going to take you places that you've never thought you could go. And I'm going to change everything. I'm turning everything upside down. Just come with me. Be with me. And so he gives the parameters for that. And we understand that this blessing, that Jesus is not a conditional thing. It's not a cause and response. It becomes this inward looking at what the kingdom of God actually looks like and how we're to live into it. Because once we start thinking about the way that God works in the world and the kingdom that he has come to establish and for our participation in it, of course you would be comforted. You're surrounded with people who love you. Of course the meek will inherit this kingdom because those are the ones, Micah 6:8, to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God. Those are kingdom people. And here's the reason you're going to do it. What Jesus said, the main purpose of him coming was that you might have life. And you may have joy. And you may have it abundantly. Not just a little bit, but a whole bunch of it. More than you'll ever know. But keep in mind, I'm changing things. You thought you were blessed when all that happened to you. I could care less about that. Your big house doesn't bless me at all. But the way that you live with each other, that matters intensely to me. So we start looking at these ideas about what it means to be a blessing and to be blessed. And if we could all get together right now and get off our smartphones, and if I had mine with me, I'd do it. We just hashtag blessing, and we create it here. We get all your responses up on the screen at one time. That's possible. We're not going to do it today. But it is possible. I was in seminary. I was in the sanctuary doing a sermon, and this is when this whole idea of hashtags and Twitter feeds was going to go on. So we all went on Twitter, and while the pastor was preaching the sermon, comments about his sermon showing up behind him on the screen. We're not going to do that either. But it is possible. Not likely, but possible. I think that you that are here, that are gathered here this morning, understand and kind of get a glimpse of this thing that I'm talking about. That we may not understand it totally. Why? That Jesus may be talking to the person that's caught up in a bottle that can't get away from it, and that is struggling with addictions and says, you're blessed. You're blessed. Walk this way and I'll show you how you're blessed. But you're blessed. And people that are out there so far who think their life has no meaning and worthwhileness anymore, Jesus is telling them as he sits there on the mountain with them, you're blessed. Of course you're blessed. Why wouldn't you be blessed? You came to meet me this far. We can walk on together. Do we see how we may look at this? We got to give up this idea that it's a cause and effect, and it's a statement about Jesus and the kingdom. And as we look inwardly at our condition, at the human condition, we will see just how much we are blessed when we put our faith and trust and hope in Christ. That blessing carries on to us and spills over into everybody that comes in contact with us, if we will allow it. Rejoice, I say rejoice. It's good news. It's good news. The kingdom of God has come near. It's here. It's now. It's in the scheme. Just waiting for you to participate in it. That's such a great picture. Can we get that happy? If we could, see, if we could get that happy just because we know the kingdom, we know the king, then if we can get that happy, there is no telling how contagious that is in this community. People will know. And what we've got to stop doing is stop blessing, trying to tell people they're blessed only if they drive the car that we do, they live in the house that we do, they eat the meals that we do. You see, that's not what Jesus is saying here. Jesus is talking to all the people that are hurting, people on the outside, people that others have given up on. Why do you think they came to see this man? If their life was perfect, why they have no need to walk out in the middle of the desert and listen to a guy talking up on the hill? You see, they're hurting people that have needs. Our community is the same way. Let's go find them.